The human body is not built to have difficult, challenging, meaningful conversations that lead to reasoned, equitable outcomes. We are, unfortunately, built to strike out at our adversary or to run for cover in the surrounding forest. The fight or flight response. Naturally, these reactions are not professional or even acceptable in the modern workplace, or anywhere else for that matter. So we tailor our behavior to more satisfactory social patterns. But beware, the underlying physiological stimulations remain present in our person. What is our typical response to a challenge? We get angry or we get gone. The fight or flight response is alive and well after hundreds of thousands of years, and it's occurring right in our break rooms, our boss's office, on the telephone with our associates, and in our homes. When we are confronted with a difficult or even uncomfortable challenge, our body immediately suggests, in its own not too subtle way, that we should put up our dukes and defend ourselves or escape the situation. The obvious problem is that the reach of these two responses is imperfect. Fleeing from a conversation you don't want to have seldom solves the issue. It's likely to push the challenge further down the road to another time, something I call deferred management if you're a supervisor. Unsurprisingly, this really doesn't do anyone any good, or it might settle the contested issue in the other party's favor. Neither of which is productive for us, so why do we do it? Without a doubt, the flight response has severe limitations. Similarly, the fight response is rife with complications. Embarrassment, discipline, termination, jail. I don't know how far someone will carry the fight response. Cast in the light most favorable possible, the fight response does little to improve our standing in most social and professional situations. Putting our guards up or going on the offensive against those that are challenging us often results in shouting matches, name-calling, and all other kinds of unfruitful outcomes that doesn't do anyone any good. The fight response serves a purpose in our continued survival, I'm certain, but remains an obvious poor choice in most professional and social encounters. There has to be a better way. So when you are challenged by someone in a confrontational way, your body comes up with two very quick ideas that have substantial downside in an office environment. And the suddenness of these ideas make either of them seem reasonable at that moment. Fleeing, at least figuratively, isn't a great idea, though I'm sure it worked well for some of our ancestors, or we wouldn't be here having this conversation in the first place. Fighting, at least figuratively, isn't going to win us many friends or influence many people about the soundness of our ideas. What to do? The first stage may be to identify when a difficult or crucial conversation is about to happen. If you can identify when a challenge is about to be put in front of you, you can at least anticipate how your body will physiologically react and that fleeing or fighting aren't the only two responses that are worthy of your consideration. How do we do this? There are three hallmarks to a crucial conversation. First, the parties to the conversation have different viewpoints on the topic. I mean, otherwise, where would we be challenged if we are all in agreement about the topic of conversation? If everyone in the group agrees that it is irrefutable that the greatest rock and roll band of all time was the Plastic Ono Band, then no one is going to feel challenged or physiologically feel the need to flee or fight. But if opinions diverge on whether to spend end of year money on a few pieces of office furniture that some people believe they really need, or to spend it on a training budget accessed by just a few senior people, the seedlings for a crucial conversation exist. Second, the stakes have to be high. People may have a difference of opinion on where the best place might be to seek a parking spot as you collectively circle the building looking for such a space, but I wouldn't say that the stakes are high in this instance. Now, if the conversation about someone's status in the group or who's going to get a big opportunity to demonstrate their skills right before a promotion selection is made, the stakes will become very high. People are very much invested in who they are, and in many workplace encounters, these are often the highest of stakes. Third, the emotions are strong. Now, this might seem like a duplication of factor number two, The stakes are high, but it's a little different. Note that even when the stakes are high, not everyone is invested, at least not emotionally. Not everyone cares who's going to get the next promotion in the office. This can be true even when the parties themselves are candidates for the position. It isn't until people have emotionally committed themselves to a position that the ground is now fertile for a crucial conversation. When all three factors, opinions vary, the stakes are high, and the emotions are strong, then a critical conversation can take place. When this occurs, watch for your body to offer two quick solutions, fight or flight. Challenge those suggestions. They aren't going to be your best option in most encounters. So keep on looking, reflection, listening, opening yourself to the topic of conversation, all should be considered. Physiologically, they just aren't suggested to us at the moment the potential crisis occurs. Give other reaction ideas a chance. I'm John Besselman, and this has been FLETC Talks.